Hi, this is Dave Dirks with Dirks Outdoors. You know, if you own land, 10 acres, 100 acres, 1,000 acres or more, whatever, one of the things that you might want to think about is improving that as a habitat resource for wildlife. And in order to do that, you've got to really invest some time and effort to make sure that you've got a woodlot, again, whatever size it is, that's really optimized to provide a healthy carrying capacity of natural foods and cover for wild animals, all kinds of wild animals. And so if you are interested in doing that, this video series is going to be right up your alley. I've enlisted the help of an excellent forester, Kelly Nywening, and Kelly and I did this video series to help you understand some of the very basic concepts and some of the things that you have to think about when you're trying to figure out how do I make this land better in terms of its ability to sustain wildlife on a natural and a long-term basis. So I hope you enjoy this series, get as much as you can out of it. And this is my reminder to you, if you wanna really do something with your property, invest some time, hire a forester to be able to do that. Thank you for listening at Dirks Outdoors.
A basic unit of forest management is called a stand. And a stand is an area on your property that has similar characteristics, be it topography, timber type, and management objective, that you can manage it as a whole. So right now we're standing on the boundary of two very distinct stands. One is a small sawtimber oak and hickory stand, and the other is an early successional brushy stand. And you'll see very clearly that these are different, both in character and recommended management. We'll manage the sawtimber stand for sawtimber, and we'll manage the brushy stand for wildlife. This is a good way to incorporate different objectives onto one piece of property. Identifying the resources you have on your forest land is an important step. If you're managing your timber in part or in whole for timber production over the long term, it's important to identify trees that will continue to gain in growth and value over time. We call these trees crop trees. Here's an example of a crop tree that's worth managing for. This is a white oak of a good diameter with a large live crown ratio. That is the amount of leaf space it has to continue to photosynthesize and grow, and minimal defects, either in sweep or in cavities or rot. There are some small epicormic branching on this stem, which will decrease the timber value somewhat, but not entirely. Your forester can help you identify those trees which are most likely to continue to grow well into the future. All the factors that impact your forest, the first and most foundational is soil type. Soil type will determine the capacity of your land to grow timber. The height growth of trees is entirely reliant on the quality and the depth of the soil, whereas diameter is reliant on the density of trees and the spacing. Height growth is completely reliant on soil. And you'll see this if you go out into the woods. You can see the difference being on the toe of a slope makes versus the top of that same slope in the height and the quality of your trees. If you're interested in determining the soil type on your property, you can do a simple Google search for NRCS, that's the Natural Resources Conservation Service, Web Soil Survey, WSS, and you can impart the property boundary of your property into the website and get a detailed output of all the soil types on your land. One of the most important aspects of timber management is stand density. That's how many trees per acre and their relative size you have. When stands are too dense, tree growth overall is slowed. Right here, we're standing in a dense patch of red oaks. You can look up and see that they're the space that they have to expand their crowns, therefore the amount of photosynthetic area they have is limited. So by thinning some of the trees that have less live crown ratio or photosynthetic space, we can maximize the growth of the trees that remain.